let go.
Is this how you'd like to be cared for when you're older?
We would have no idea what went on with Dad had we not had the cameras in there.
Hello, I'm Nick Haines. You've just watched our new film on aging. Now we dig for answers. We're heading to the Kansas City Plaza Library for a town hall on the state of aging in our metro. We have the experts and a big audience. We also have a front row seat for you. Next on Kansas City PBS.
I didn't want her to have to spend another day with people that were not sympathetic to her.
And so if I hadn't been here, it would have been one more night that she not only would have been in pain, but she also would have been hungry. And I'm just not sure that it would have been addressed.
What residents often tell us, I wish I would have died than to live like this.
And you've been watching How Should We Care on Kansas City PBS. Hello, I'm Nick Haines. By a show of hands, how many of us in this room are getting younger? Oh, okay, all righty. That's what I thought. We are all aging. America is aging. By 2030, according to the US Census, Americans 65 and older will, for the very first time in the country's history, outnumber children. Who's going to look after all of these people? And how are we doing it now? And that's the purpose of our next hour together. And we've got a think tank of experts with us who can turn to for answers for some of our peskiest questions. You just saw Camille Russell in the documentary. She is the Kansas Long-Term Care Ombudsman who looks at the citizen complaints about elder care facilities in Kansas. She's coming to us from Topeka. By the way, she also serves under two Kansas Attorney Generals as Director of the Abuse, Neglect, and Exploitation Unit. Melody Elston is just wrapping up an assignment as Interim Aging Director at the Mid-America Regional Council, which keeps a broad eye on issues and trends involving elder care on both sides of state line. Janet Baker's full-time job is empowering, celebrating, and serving older adults to help them age gracefully in Kansas City. She lives the challenge every day as director of the Kansas City Shepherds Center. She doesn't have a white coat or a stethoscope strategically placed around her neck, but Dr. Jessica Callender-Rich is a geriatrician at the University of Kansas Health System who teaches about the care of aging adults and works closely with the Landon Center on Aging. And Samantha Shepherd is the founding partner of the Shepherd Elder Law Group, which has offices in Overland Park, Kansas, and Hutchinson. She spends every day talking to families, navigating those tough financial, health, and emotional problems involving elder care planning. Please welcome our panel to the stage here. By the way, we also have filmmaker Michael Price with us, who spent basically, Michael, a year of your life lifting up the hood on adult living facilities, nursing homes, looking at aging in place in Kansas City. What was the big take home for you having done that film?
Well, because the film itself took me into, sadly, one of the main issues that too many people face, which is going into a long-term care facility where they're receiving substandard care. And of course, in some instances, I was spending time with the families of those people. What I quickly came to realize is the impact of that on the families outside of the care home, as it were, who aren't putting their loved ones in these care homes and then washing their hands. They care for them still. They love for them. They still love them. They're trying to monitor the care. They're trying to improve the care. They're advocating for conditions to improve. And it's a devastating reality for them as well when week after week, they're witnessing, they're sort of vicariously experiencing the substandard care for their loved one. It's a huge issue for too many people. I'd say that's my main takeaway.
Michael Price, thank you very much. Camille Russell, we saw you in the documentary. You said there were some people who come to you as the long-term care ombudsman and say they would prefer to be at a van in the river by the river rather than be in one of these facilities. Really?
It's actually what I tell my family. I say it would be preferable to me to be living in a van by the river than don't put me in a nursing home.
When COVID happened, the Washington Post claimed that there was no more dangerous place to be in America than a nursing home, not just for the patients, but for the staff as well. You just served on the coronavirus nursing home task force there. Did that change, COVID change people's perceptions and say, you know, I'd never want to go there anymore?
You know, I think COVID really exposed some of the challenges that had been already in place in many of these facilities. In addition, the staffing impact that happened during the pandemic when people really didn't feel comfortable working any longer in that setting because of all of the things that you mentioned and not feeling safe, that really just compounded the issue.
We have the impression, of course, that we have tons of regulations. The state looks after these things, the federal government does. The federal law requires that there be a comprehensive inspection at least every 15 months. But one in four Missouri nursing homes have not had an inspection in more than 2 years, according to ProPublica. Kansas has its own issues. Even before the pandemic, less than 40% of nursing homes met the federal government inspection target. Are there simply not enough inspectors?
There are not enough inspectors, and there are not enough of the right inspectors. We're under-resourced, and it's amazing what they get done with the few resources, but the playing field's really unlevel, and it's in the favor of the providers.
What are the red flags we should be paying attention to before we consider that choice?
First of all, when you walk in, I say use your five senses. You want to look and see what you observe as far as the residents who are there. You want to hear if there are call lights, you know, going off and no one attending to them. You want to smell. You want to look at what the residents are wearing, if they're still in their sleeping clothes or if they're dressed. So there are, just use your five senses and you can kind of gauge, you know, the quality of that home.
Dr. Jessica, you were also a medical director at a nursing home. What are the red flags that you tell patients or their families who may be feeling they need to go to a long-term care facility?
So I actually tell people to stop by, to use those five senses, but to stop by and not at noon on a Monday, but to actually stop by on a weekend or an evening and see how things feel and sound and smell. In addition to that, really just asking all of the questions that are burning in all of our minds. And because we all have questions, right?
What's the biggest question that you hear?
I mean, the biggest question I think that I hear is, you know, are you going to care for my loved one, right? A different question we could be asking is, how are you going to care for my loved one?
When you, again, you're dealing with this every day. You have clients coming into your home, you have family members who are worried about making a decision. What are the red flags? What do you tell them about how to choose a long-term care facility?
Exactly as the others are saying, I say go at unexpected times. Don't wait for an invitation. It's a home, which means that you're allowed to show up. You don't need an appointment with the admissions personnel. You show up.
Now, one expert, again, tells us you should make an unannounced visit prior to choosing a facility. Are they just going to hate you for doing that, though?
If they're going to hate you for doing that, that's a red flag. That's not where you want your parent, your loved one to live. So that's the last place. And the person that's going to live there, I don't know about any of you, but do you buy a home without seeing it yourself? Why would we have our loved one go live somewhere that they didn't visit?
I would also say speak to the residents, you know, the people who are walking around or, you know, observing the birdcage or whatever's there, you know, speak to the residents, ask them, and speak to their loved ones if they're visiting. They will be able to give you honest insight on the care of their loved one and what concerns are there.
Now, we've been told by some aging experts that you should be actually looking into assisted living or nursing homes before your loved one actually needs it because there are, we're told, substantial waiting lists. Is that really a big problem that for all these facilities that we see now popping up all over our metro, wherever there's a spare piece of land, it seems to be, we have a new assisted living facility or a nursing home, there are waiting lists, ma'am?
Absolutely. Some of them are 18 months long. I advise someone today to go to one particular place while they could manage and get on the waiting list for the other, which I think is perhaps a 12-month wait.
This is sounding a little bit like people with childcare, that even before the baby is born, they're now considering the childcare option.
And you don't want to learn when you're in the moment of crisis. If you're an aging person now and you see signs, well, I suppose you don't usually see your own signs, but if one of your family members has dementia and you're considering when is the right time for placement, I hate the idea that you've waited to the moment of crisis to then start exploring.
The AARP has a study out, a recent study, that says 77% of people over 50 want to age at home. Janet Baker, that's what you do. That's about the wraparound service allowing people to age at home. What is the number one obstacle in Kansas City to doing that?
Well, I would say for nonprofit organizations like Kansas City Shepherd Center, the number one obstacle is sustainable funding to support the true wraparound services that are needed to help an older adult live in their own homes and their communities with the wraparound services they need. We have all of our programs like Meals on Wheels, Senior Companions, Phone Pals, Adventures in Learning. We can provide the entire plethora of programs and services to make it possible for older adults to live safely, happily, independently in their own homes for about the cost of a day in the hospital for a year.
You mentioned 77% said that they would like
prefer
to age at
home.
Well, but once they're there, I would tell you that they tell long-term care ombudsman a much higher percentage that they wish they had done more, but more planning and done it different. They accommodated fear of their family members to be there and things like that. They'd wish they had stayed at home longer, that they'd planned. And we could do that with less money, like Janet said.
My wife, by the way, was a fitness specialist at one of the most luxurious assisted living facilities in our metropolitan area. And I've been goading her, trying to get information from her, and the people, the residents she has spoken with, every single one of them has told her their only regret is they waited too long to get there. You provided security, you provided a lot of different things that you might not get if you're aging at home.
So you said something that's gonna irritate me all night.
Okay.
A luxurious place. So who defines luxury there? So you know what I find if it's the children, and I do have a Johnson County practice as well as a Kansas City practice, so we get rubbed a little bit for that. So there's an appeal to the children for the outside lobby. Can I beg you to go beyond the lobby? So the luxury, I'm not trying to fault you for your perception that the place is luxurious because the lobby is, but maybe I am actually.
Okay. Who else is faulting me for luxury? Yes, Melody.
I'll speak to the fact that the service staff usually travel to each long-term care facility. So just because the facility appears luxurious, the care may be the same.
I think about luxury, and I'm going to say the word, because this is really a lot of people's concern, is how do you afford to stay in some of these facilities? The current cost of a nursing home hovers around $100,000 a year. Who has the money to pay $8,000 to $9,000 a month to get that kind of care? Isn't that luxury?
I will tell you that the older adults in Kansas City with a median income in their lifetime of $58,000 a year can't. And the people that we serve, who are largely low-income, older adults, and particularly people of color, who didn't have jobs where they accrued much Social Security and didn't have positions where they accrued any kind of pension, can't.
Well, we've got to do something different. We've got to. And we've got to look at what the billions of dollars that we are spending on long-term care, where it's going. We've got to look at true transparency to make sure that the money is going to the actual cost for direct care and is not being pilfered off.
We completely box them in. So our government dollars are paying, I'm not running for office so I can say what I need to say. So our government dollars are going to pay for Medicaid, and I help people get on Medicaid every day, but we will not pay for assisted living, hardly at all in Missouri. So that's an impractical financial calculation. As you said, 100,000, if you're lucky, it might be closer to 120,000 a year. We're forcing people to go into the nursing home who could stay in assisted living or could stay at home because we won't put our dollars there.
Something that came out of this film that was surprising to me, and I'm pleased, this is another area, you got mad at me over the luxurious one.
I'm sorry.
I use interchangeably sort of assisted living and nursing homes. And yet what a huge difference there is, and I can see that guy nodding there in agreement, but also in terms of the law, that was kind of surprising. For instance, people whose nursing home bills are paid by Medicaid are protected by federal law from eviction. They can't be removing you, but that's not true of assisted living.
And yet it's one of the biggest issues that long-term care ombudsmen have dealt with years is evictions. And people in assisted livings often do not have the same rights. And it is important that they be able to appeal and have those legal remedies that you and I would have if we rented an apartment out in the community.
And she mentioned rights, and I think that speaks to how to advocate for your loved one. Know their rights. Know that they have the rights that anyone would have in the community to make those decisions. So knowing the rights while you're in long-term care plays a major role in the quality a lot of times.
In the film, staffing is the big issue. The nation's largest nursing home lobbying group says 52 nursing homes in Kansas have closed due to staffing issues since the onset of the pandemic. In fact, one industry survey conducted in December found 8 out of 10 nursing homes in the country experienced a staffing shortage. So what does that mean for us now beginning to think about elder care, Dr. Jessica?
There really are not enough people working in these facilities to take care of them in the way that we believe and they deserve to be taken care of.
I went to a symposium on aging at the University of Kansas, and they had, as part of a panel, a funeral home director from Texas who said at this symposium, and it's burned into my brain, he says, I can always tell as a funeral director if the person has been looked after at home or they've been looked after in a nursing home, the person who was in the nursing home is in a lot better shape. I can see Janet looking at me. The argument being, Janet, why would you expect someone at home, and we want to make this a mythical experience, we're so good, we're so morally upright, we're looking after our loved one at home, but there's just you. And you may be older yourself, you may have your own issues, and now it may take, you know, a team of 6 to 8 people looking after you in a, you know, assisted living facility. You've got a lot more care, a lot more support.
Well, except to the extent that you're hearing from these experts that the staffing is the issue and you're not getting that level of support. So perhaps he lived in a different kind of community than we have.
But, okay, but Camille deals with the people who are complaining. You're dealing with a lot of other folks. Are they happy being in assisted living facilities, nursing homes? Are you tracking folks who come through your office, Samantha?
Of course I am. But I have a personal experience that I'm just going to pray for 1 minute that my mother's not watching, okay? So cut this out of the clip. My father died at home. The day he died, she said to me, she called that last day and said, okay, you can take him. I work in this field. Did I want that? But my mother is less than 100 pounds. My father had ALS. He had bed sores. And I work in this field. We couldn't move him, the two of us. Sometimes your own limitations as a human, as a daughter, as a mother, require you to seek alternative care.
But that's my whole point about being able to age in place and having the support services needed to augment what a family can do. And those services are available. And everything that nonprofits like Shepherd Center does are at no expense to the family that require philanthropic funding that is very difficult to get. But my position is invest in prevention. It's far less expensive than paying for failure. And at the beginning of the day, if we invested in the support services to keep people supported at their home, then we wouldn't be waiting until the last minute and then getting a substandard care in a nursing home.
We've already got a lot of questions coming in already from our own audience since we started the whole project. We heard from Sandy in Merriam, Kansas, who writes, my dad refuses to consider moving into assisted living. He's in his late 80s, a cancer survivor, and taking care of my mother who has mild dementia. How can I bring this up with my parents and help them understand that assisted living would be good for everyone and it's not what they think it is? Dr. Jessica.
I want to know why he doesn't want to move there. And what can we do to find the things that he's seeking in a specific, in assisted living?
Or at home.
Or at home, right. So whatever setting can be safest.
We know what lane you're traveling in, Janet.
I'm right down the middle. I'm in that lane.
And so sometimes good for you, like how can we convince, it might not be good for him. You know, I think the problem is that sometimes we look at making decisions for older adults because they don't know better, but they've been with themselves for however old they are. And so they're the experts in what they want for themselves. So if he wants to age in home in place until you can't do it anymore, I think that's a viable option. And then his rights and his own, his integrity and his dignity are present.
Agreed.
I want to go back to the staffing issue which we talked about. Something you may not be aware of is that the former governor of Kansas, if you remember, Kathleen Sebelius was the governor of Kansas. She became health secretary in the Obama administration. Remember that? And then Mark Parkinson became governor, and he was in the nursing home industry in Lenexa. And he became governor, and today he is the head of the American Health Association, Healthcare Association, which is the leading nursing home lobbying group in the entire country. And he does that for a living, and that's what he's doing now. He has been lobbying Congress, and he says the industry is operating with the lowest number of workers since 1995. He's proposed changing immigration law so American nursing homes can tap into a global talent pool to boost its workforce. Camille, is that the solution?
We don't need more underpaid people caring for people. What we need is well-trained people. Thank you. We need well-trained people who are treated well, who are paid a living wage and have benefits. That's what we need.
As she mentioned, the living wage and trained well. In addition to, they need to recognize that the direct care staff actually work the hardest in the facilities. And I believe that if we respected the direct care staff like they deserve, then people would, you know, be more interested in going into that industry.
People didn't realize that during COVID, of course, because people were on low pay, they may not have had paid leave, they still came to work because they couldn't afford not to have a paycheck, you know, furthering the COVID spread. Heather, who's an administrator with Evergreen Community Care in Olathe, hi, Heather, she says, for every person we hire, it seems like two are leaving. We've heard from some care workers who claim they can make just as much working at Target and they don't have to clean up feces, vomit, or be shouted at by family members. So how much of this is a pay issue?
A lot. I would agree. I think all five of us would tell you that it's part of it is it's an industry that is undercompensated. And I don't think there's one of us up here who would think that there is not a staffing crisis.
Undercompensated and also underrespected. I mean, it really does come back to these people are taking care of our loved ones. And we need to respect them, and the facility needs to respect them, and really the whole community needs to put them up on a pedestal for what they're doing.
If that is the situation right now, and I said at the very beginning, we're now heading to a much more bigger aging population. How about the rest of us in this auditorium here at the Kansas City Plaza Library? What's that care going to look like for us if we have a staffing issue right now and we're closing more than 50 nursing homes in the state of Kansas in just the last 3 years?
I would agree with that premise. And I would also say there's a significant role for public policy in this discussion. We have an opportunity to go to Congress, to go to the state legislatures. I'm a silver-haired legislator myself for the state of Missouri, to advocate for policy that helps people remain in their homes, to give them property tax relief, to not tax Social Security, which we just finally are addressing in Missouri, one of the last 11 states to tax Social Security. We need to deal with things that allow people to spend the resources they have to remain at home rather than be the victims of a government that doesn't care.
There are powerful lobbyists, and we all need to speak up for ourselves because there's powerful lobbyists talking to those legislators, and those lobbyists are speaking up for the providers, for the business. We need those businesses to care about the business they're in.
But we do need providers to have staffing in place, and the nursing home industry is also advocating for changes in Congress. One of those before Congress right now is called the Care for Our Senior Act that would incentivize people to choose a career in long-term care. We said it's a problem. Nobody wants to work there. They don't want to have feces and be shouted at by family members. So they want to provide loan forgiveness and housing and child care assistance for those who go into long-term care, which currently are some of the lowest paid people in the entire healthcare sector. Is that the solution?
Well, it can't hurt. I mean, think about some people love babies and some people love seniors. I love little old people, no offense to the rest of you. But there are people who don't find that elder law is very exciting. It's not a particularly robust section of the entering body of young attorneys, shall we say? And it's the same, I would imagine, with other fields. So any incentive that helps encourage the growth of the industry, I'm for.
I think it's not the solution, but it's a solution. And we need to stop looking at it as though there's a panacea. If we just do one thing, it will fix the problem.
We're going to take your questions if you have any. I've got plenty of my own, but we'd love to hear what your thoughts, concerns are during this panel as well. You mentioned what the panacea is. I think there one may be one right at hand. As technologies advance, we have on-body wearables, we have in-home sensors, though we can connect healthcare devices to people living in their home. Technology could be the solution. Will robots be providing for our care? We like to think of the way things are right now. What's the future gonna hold? Here's a quick clip for one of my favorite films.
Wake up, Frank. It's 7, Frank. Wake up. Frank. It's crucial that we establish a set schedule for your day to help keep you oriented.
Just bring me some cereal.
That cereal is full of unhealthy ingredients. I threw it away.
Don't throw away my stuff.
Frank, that cereal is for children. Enjoy this grapefruit.
You're for children, stupid.
Today we're going to start a garden. Frank, you need a project. Mental stimulation plus a regimented schedule will vastly improve your cognitive functioning. Besides, it's good exercise. Frank, we're going to have to work together.
You are a robot butler.
I'm not a butler, Frank. I'm a healthcare aide, programmed to monitor and improve your physical and mental health.
Yeah, get out of my house.
Oh, hi. Could you do with one of those? No? Yes? Keep your head... You know, we view things statically right now that we have staffing issues, but, you know, technology, AI, all of these things, isn't this a possibility?
I think it's a possibility. I think a robot could reach things that that someone who wasn't able to reach things would be able to reach. I think a robot could bring something and it just really offset those actual mobility issues.
Yeah, but that doesn't deal with the social isolation and loneliness, right? And we know that social isolation and loneliness kills, right? It increases the rate of dementia by 50%, increases the rate of mortality by all causes by 40%. It is the human connection is critical to longevity and health and well-being.
Which is one reason sometimes when I meet with a family, I'm encouraging the transition from home in the family home, since the wife has passed away and he's not eating. And he doesn't want to move to a nursing home, God no, but perhaps he would consider the next level, the independent living, where he has someone who will notice if he shows up for breakfast. So it's still home. And if we encourage these steps, so the first independent, then assisted, we can keep people out of nursing homes longer if we as children encourage and open our minds to these other possibilities.
I mean, we talked earlier about prevention, right? Prevention being the key. And so prevention is not only keeping people healthy, keeping people moving, but it's also keeping people engaged in their community and keeping people at home, but maybe not in the place that they have lived for the last 50 years, right? In any place that they feel like is their home. That's what's important there. And that includes interacting with other people. That includes being able to do what they can do as independently as possible, as long as possible.
No, I was thumbs up.
Oh, thumbs up, finally.
That was it.
Well, she was speaking to home and how people, I think that when you do plan to transition into whatever model that the individual is included in that decision making, that would allow them to select their home as opposed to saying, okay, you have to go to this. I think including the older adult into the conversation, do tours, and provide options to help make that decision. It allows that transition and also allows them to be oriented into their home.
You know, a dignified as a living would require that we make our own choices. And we all are sitting here talking about what we're gonna do for other people, but they're supposed to be the center. They should be the focus and the center of control. We all want to be the center of control of our own lives. We don't want other people to make our decisions for us.
And we have a right to do that.
And we have every right to do that.
We have an absolute right to do that. I was just actually sitting here imagining if my grown children came to me and said, here's where you're gonna live and here's what, I wish they would. I'll be 65 in a minute, so, you know, I am an older adult, but no.
Well, actually, back on the, you know, and it was Samantha who mentioned the language thing earlier, talking about luxury, but language matters to our viewers too. We had a lot of questions relating to that. Some of our viewers have made it very clear to us that they despise being called senior. How should we respectfully refer to older people? Older person, senior citizen, elderly? What do you say? Marilyn in Overland Park says there seems to be no perfect solution. She writes, when you go to a store, should they offer you a senior discount or a wisdom discount? So, I mean, how about language on that regards, and how do you handle that in your own spheres of influence?
I believe language is extremely important. I think senior is an othering word where you are, you know, pushing someone away from your own humanity at sometimes. And so, but I also recognize that it's embedded in, you know, how we operate. And so there are times where I'll refer to something just because people don't understand any other language, but we use older adult in the work we use, or over 60, or, you know, just a reference.
What do you use, Dr. Jessica?
I say older adult, but I have to say something really important. Age is just a number.
Amen.
So this is really not about whether you're an older adult or an older adult, right? This is really about how you remain and maintain independent as you can be, and how you gain that and continue to have that autonomy, whether you're at home, in independent living, assisted living, a long-term care, wherever you are. Your age is just your number, how many years you've been on earth.
What is old? I mean, shout back at me, is 55 old? Is 60 old?
No.
Is 65 old?
No.
Is 70 old?
No.
Is 75 old?
No.
Is 80 old?
Yes.
85 old?
Somebody say yes.
Okay, we're between 80 and 85. You know, it is interesting when we talk about it that way. What number are we referring to? The AARP, of course, will say, you know, 55, you get their card and you get the discounts.
That needs to change.
That needs to change.
Yeah, I like my discounts. Leave my discounts.
You've got another 4 years to wait on that, though, Samantha. Thank you. I'm ingratiating myself to you now.
What do you want?
Well, we could qualify something based on our age, but we don't need to be labeled as a certain label. And I think I can be young at heart and just maybe older in other parts. But anyway, so you qualify for something based on age, or you can buy alcohol because of you're a certain age. I don't think we need to label it, and I prefer to be called by my name. Thank you.
Okay. Becky, who lives out in Red Bridge, says she calls herself a perennial. Is she onto something? What do you think about that word? Nah, you're not keen on that. No. Does anybody have a better word? Dinosaur was one I just heard. That was rude, terribly rude. Mature. Mature is just sufficient. Okay, we glossed over it a little bit, was the cost of care. So how do we think about that, and what should we be at home worried possibly when I mention the price tag of $100,000 a year? What should we be doing if I'm sitting in the audience here wondering how may I be thinking about paying for that in the future? And what step should I be taking?
Ooh, my turn.
Samantha.
Do I get an hour now? Because this is what I like to talk about.
This is what you spend most of your time talking about?
Yeah, probably.
Okay.
How do we finance this? How do we pay for it? And I prefer not to do what it is that I do all the time, which is my dad has been discharged to a rehab. They've told us he's not coming home. My mother can't stay at home alone. He's always paid the bills. She keeps saying 14 times over, when are you coming home? What time is it? And we've gotten the first bill, and it's $12,000. So that then brings Medicaid into the forefront of every normal family that I know. No people, typical people, think I should have $120,000 every year for 2 years, 3 years, or 12 years to pay for my care. Long-term care is expensive. I'm probably alienating every professional I've ever worked with. Long-term care insurance is not expensive.
Okay. Yeah, but there is such a thing as elder care insurance.
So,
how many of your clients have it when they come
very
to you?
Few, and very we celebrate when they
because it's
they
so
do.
Expensive.
It is expensive.
It's expensive.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. What are we talking about when we're talking about expensive? $1,000 a month premiums? More than that?
Probably about that. I've seen a variation. What I've seen, I'm really going to have a black ball on my face. My car's tires are probably going to be squished by the time I get out there. What I've seen is that you get a lovely letter in the mail. You've been paying for your long-term care insurance for 20 years, and these sweet little 80-year-olds come into me saying, well, I got a notice saying the premium was going up, so I've dropped it down and I've dropped it down. Now they get $50 a day with a 90-day elimination that's going to last for 6 months. Well, what good is that? And they had no choice.
Janet, if you're looking after a loved one at home, that can be expensive too. Is there any help, financial help, as an individual, if you're looking after someone and you're the caregiver at home?
There are some, Melody mentions the caregiver program through the state that you can receive as a family member some reimbursement for caregiving in the home. We have many programs in the community that are at no expense to the family or to the older adult, thanks to funders like Mid-America Regional Council and the federal government and philanthropists and foundations. So much of what is needed, depending on the situation for that particular family, can be provided by a community network. It should be, in my judgment, provided by business. It is the return on investment of keeping someone at home and out of the emergency room and out of hospitals should be job one for health insurance companies. It's enlightened self-interest for them to keep people well.
Melody.
I think we look at long-term care as a long-term end-all solution. So once someone is in long-term care, they're there. And I think if you have to go to long-term care after you were discharged from rehab, you can plan to return home. I don't think it has to be a permanent solution. So the discharge planners in the facilities are supposed to constantly meet with the residents and discuss discharge. Believe it or not, I know it doesn't happen, but I was a social services director, so I know that is one of their jobs, is to really look at discharge options. How can we get you home with the resources and the services that you need? That doesn't happen.
She's right. It's supposed to be happening. People go to the hospital. The hospital recommends a little bit of rehab, that go to the nursing home. There is supposed to be discharge planning from that nursing home. And almost every resident tells us, I'm only going to be here for a little while, but they aren't getting the therapy they're supposed to get. They decline in the nursing home oftentimes instead of getting better. And they don't get home. Or if, quite frankly, if they're capable of going home, those folks are easier to take care of, and there's not a real incentive for those businesses to let loose of them.
That's what I was going to mention. There's a capitalistic element to institutional care, that keeping people in there is where they get their reimbursement from Medicare, from Medicaid, from the families.
There may be a term that we're using because we do talk industry vernacular. The discharge planner is a nasty sound, but that is the name of the social worker who's supposed to guide the family, explore the different options, and then supposed to know about the difference between Medicare and Medicaid and rehab. But I want to pause. You need to tell them more about Shepherd Center, because you were telling me things I didn't know about how great some of the freebies are.
We want freebies, don't we? Well, that's what we came here for. 36% of our audience came for the free air conditioning. You know, it's really hot out there today. But the rest of us are looking for freebies. What have you got for us, Janet?
Well, and as I mentioned, and thank you so much for that introduction. So as I mentioned, most of the programs and services we provide to help keep people in their homes is at no expense. And so, you know, when I say we
like
can...
Like what?
Like Meals on Wheels, a daily well check and a hot meal 5 days a week.
Is anybody eligible for that?
Jackson County.
No, that's Meals on Wheels is all counties. But you have to be over 60. And
that doesn't even qualify as old for this audience.
No, it doesn't. So, you know, keep and homebound. And that is the real eligibility criteria, is that this is what allows us to be the eyes and ears for a family, to deliver through our volunteers and our staff drivers a daily well check. And then we can call a family member and say, you know, something's not quite right with Mary today. Get them into maybe a primary care setting and get them back home, rather than waiting until there's a fall, waiting till there's a progressive illness, and then they are taken into a nursing home or long-term care. So all of those programs, as I say, prevention rather than failure. Let's invest up front in keeping people at home at no expense to them or minimal expense to them. We can do the whole thing for, you know, $3,000 a year rather than $7,000 to $10,000 a month to be institutionalized.
We can still take your questions or comments if you have any, but we're talking about this. Would you like to come to the microphone, sir? Thank you very much. We love that. You'll probably get a Kansas City PBS mug for being the first person to come to the microphone. Bigger prizes, including brand new vehicles coming for number 2 and 3. I don't want to say too much, but sir, we're ready for you.
One of the things I've noticed with keeping our loved ones in their home is the dependency they have on caretakers. And I haven't heard anything about the caretaker support. They're the ones that are really taking the brunt of everything. I watched my mom take care of my father for 9 years while he was spinning into dementia. We just recently placed him, but during those 9 years, it almost destroyed my mother. This is 6 months later, and we're still trying to get her back. So that's an issue, because when a caretaker completely bottoms out, then the person they're taking care of doesn't have any other options. So I'd like to hear everyone's opinion. I know Janet's, I know mine, but I'd love to hear the rest of the panel discuss it.
Thank you very much.
Can we first ask, how many people in here have been caregivers?
This is a big, big percentage. So you're hitting some things there, sir.
So at the Area Agency on Aging, we have resources and supports for caregivers. We have classes, trainings, Care Techs, which offers different trainings and different things for people who provide care for their loved ones. And I think one issue with a lot of the issues facing the older adults is knowledge, having information about resources available, knowing that there are caregiver supports, knowing that there are respite programs out there. If you want to go take a couple of hours a day, there are respite programs out there with no out-of-pocket cost if you qualify. So just having knowledge about what resources are available to support you while you support your loved one.
When you say qualify, is that based on income?
No income.
You know, there are significant supports that people don't know about. She's right about the information. And one thing we've done in our country for a long time is those are funded a lot by federal monies. And what we've done for a long time is we fund those things, but there are rules where they can't use any of that money for those huge grants that are put in place to inform and market those programs, often because businesses become upset about that. But if we could just have a small amount of the money, if you fund a program for $100 million, if you could put a few dollars into letting people know about it, it would be helpful.
Yes. Dr. Jessica, you were getting so choked up about this. This is so, you're so passionate about it. I know that. Samantha is also passionate about it.
I am, but I was wondering if we needed a doctor. I was just giving her a hard time. Poor woman. I'd like to say that the caregivers are unsupported, but I think we all know. I told this analogy to a lady today, and I said, you're like the frog in the water. If you were a frog and I dropped you in boiling water, you'd hop out. You know this is untenable. You have gone to the point where you're the 24-hour caregiver. She was describing the dementia in such a way that he's abusive, verbally abusive, and possibly physically abusive, because the daughter said, I don't want to find you at the bottom of the stairs. That was a quote from today. So I'm not a big proponent of nursing homes. But there is a time. And there are some wonderful nursing homes. And then the question is, how do we pay? And that's when we have to learn how to navigate through Medicaid.
But you're proving a point from the Texas funeral director I referenced earlier that Janet pushed back against, that we can wait too long and wear ourselves out as caregivers when it may make sense for us to say we need a different option.
I don't disagree, but every situation's different. And what we don't have is we don't have a good ecosystem in the aging space. We're a patchwork of individual programs and services.
Dr. Jessica, by the way, you just got the cough drop, and we're using health system rules. That would be $75.
Right.
Okay, all right. Okay, all right.
Would you like to sign the release?
I need to sign something.
Okay, they might have cut your mic. We got it back up again. Did you want to say something on the caregiver issue?
She asked if she needed to sign a release.
Madam, you've been very patient. We're ready for your question.
I abhor the thought I'm like you, I'd rather be in a van by the river than be in a nursing home. I watched my mom being in a nursing home for 7 months before she died after having a stroke. And the smell in nursing homes just gets me right away. As soon as I walked in, how can we best advocate for ourselves with state, city, federal governments?
I would recommend, there's nothing better than self-advocacy. And the only way to self-advocacy is knowledge. And the only way to knowledge is inform yourselves. We at Kansas City Shepherd Center have embarked on an advocacy strategy. Come to our website, kcshepherdcenter.org, and we will facilitate you getting involved in local and state and primarily regional advocacy efforts.
We are going to put that on our website, which is kansascitypbs.org/aging, and we'll add all of the resources mentioned in this program, Melody.
Janet mentioned self-advocacy, and another way you can advocate for yourself is to outline your wishes ahead of time before the crisis. So there are packets like 5 wishes where it goes into details. If this happens, this is what I want. If this happens, this is what I want. And get those things notarized and make sure they're in a place where people know that they are so that your wishes are known in case that situation occurs.
And our great questioner there mentioned at the very beginning just the smell of a nursing home, but how many newer facilities now bake fresh cookies in the front lobby area? So when you come in, you have this pleasant aroma. Isn't that right? That's one of the secrets today.
Well, I don't know about that. I don't see that many that do that, Nick, but,
all right,
but thank
fine.
You.
Samantha, and that might be one of the luxurious ones. Okay, that was one of the luxurious ones. Sir, thank you for your patience.
I noticed that you all are women. And
thank
that brings me to my question, first part of my question, is that would it be a good idea to get more men involved in nursing home care? Would that be helpful, or are we just... because of the nurturing nature of y'all, are we just going to have to take that gender ratio and also the age of the people who work in nursing homes? What do you think is the ideal age to be working in a nursing home, taking care of old people?
Thank you very much. This is great. Great. Janet?
I have to address the female aspect of health and human services, and particularly with nonprofits, is largely compensation driven. It is typically women who end up in social work and in nonprofits. We struggle to find any men who want to work in a small direct service nonprofit because oftentimes that pay gap in corporate America is just too enticing.
I would just piggyback off of what Janet said. It's a human services field. And so a lot of it speaks to the compensation. It speaks to maybe a nurturing nature. I don't want to stereotype us women, but that's what we're looking at.
Dr. Jessica.
But I want to answer at the question you asked, and that is yes, we
yes,
need more
you.
Men
yes.
in this field. We need all of the people to really stand up there and help all of the people. We are all hopefully going to be older adults someday. And we need to all be ready for that.
We always like to think of ourselves, we're talking about somebody else, but it is us. All of us are going to be doing that. Even our young interns at our television stations, oh, why are you doing aging? Well, we're all going to be in this age category ourselves. We need to be thinking about it.
And real quick, how about the age? What's a good age for somebody in a
nursing? Or is that irrelevant?
Anyone that cares, and all hands on deck.
You don't think it's relevant?
There's
you don't
a
worry about 50 or 20 or something
right,
like
there
that.
There are different jobs for different people. You can have somebody who perhaps is similarly aged to those people that are living in a nursing facility that can go in and play games and hang out with them and help socialize. And there could be younger people that can come in and do different things. There is a space for everyone, and there's always a need.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Your question, sir.
Nick, before he answers that, you took one of, I'm not sure which of you was speaking about preparation, and I want to say legal documents, power of attorney, your basic healthcare power of attorney. It's the document that you have that tells the world who can speak for you when you are not able to speak for yourself. Your spouse does not have that power. Your financial power of attorney, your spouse does not have automatic power to your 401k. Your biggest source of money these days, your retirement assets. Your spouse does not have access in a moment of crisis. even if you are the beneficiary. My response then is, you are not dead. So get a power of attorney, please.
I want to be respectful of people's time. Let's keep it nice and crisp, and we're going to get it done. Yes, sir, we're ready for you.
Addressing an unanswered question before, that is on terminology. I didn't hear what I'd like to have heard. I heard, and I didn't hear Pip's previously important people. And other euphemisms, Romeos, retired old men eating out. I speak from the position of retired physician and amateur student of cultures, and I truly believe words mean things. The word I didn't hear, I heard elderly, I did not hear elders. And that's a cultural thing.
And you prefer that?
It's a standalone. Other cultures, they honor their elders. And from my military background, it's the young people that are causing the problems, not the elders. The loya jurgas and people like that are pushed aside. So that's it, elders.
I really appreciate your perspective. Thank you for mentioning that. It is, I think, we have an American problem in honoring and respecting our elders. And it's very hard to change the language from our own little personal piece of the pie. But as a society, we do not have a system that respects and honors our elders.
And can I say that that has been modeled, and that's why it's like that? You know, I think that a lot of times if we're not in those shoes, we don't have a passion. So if it doesn't apply to me, then it doesn't matter until it applies to me. And so the culture models what they've been taught as far as not caring for older adults. I have a respect for older adults because who raised me was an older woman. So I've just innately, and she always ingrained that, but it has to be modeled. And another way to model it is intergenerationality. You know, bring children amongst older adults, you know, have that activity so that they recognize and value older adults.
This, I just have to say, this befuddles me more than any other single point. How many people here have parents? How many people had grandparents, right? How do we not love our elders? And yet our society, we love puppies and babies. I love puppies and babies, have both. But at some point, do we not all have this in common, that we should care about our elders and develop systems to support a healthy aging process?
We pay an awful lot of lip service to it, that we respect our elders, but clearly we don't, including your philanthropic giving you mentioned is just 1% for aging programs. And you are going to be the last questioner. You're going to have people reaching for Kleenexes with rapturous applause because of the excellence of this question. And we are ready for you, madam. I'm putting a lot of pressure on you.
Okay. I have a long history of being in not-for-profits in this city as an advocate, self-advocate, and teamed with other people who are interested in the same causes. And then when the pandemic came, when my mother went through all stuff in an assisted living for a year, I decided I'm going to find out what I can do. And during the pandemic, and see what, so I called all over. I called Mark, I called the city, I called various places, and one of the agencies here, and was told that there's a gray-haired legislature or a something or other or something or other, and I could, oh yes, we need people like you, and we've got a commission. Do you know I didn't get a call back from any of them?
Will you wait for me after this evening? Yeah, when someone raises their hand and says, I want to help, you are not
all
getting
right
out of this
we're
room.
We're giving out the personal cell phones of every one of these panelists on the show, okay?
No, so, I'm not complaining. It's
free legal
I know
advice
how hard
over here,
is,
free medical appointments
but
here.
But there are people who try,
yes,
and they don't get what they are looking for.
And because this is one of the reasons for doing this program, because some issues are just so complicated, hard to navigate. We called this program, by the way, the State of Aging. What's the one thing we could do in Kansas City now, or our region, to improve the way we age with dignity in this community? Melody.
I would say talk about it like we're doing, put the issues to the forefront, and then be involved, have involvement in a lot of the planning, and tell people about the resources that are available.
Camille.
People have to care for people. I mean, we make that, we call ourselves the Ombudsman Program. We say we're drips because we gently, but drips break through stone eventually. And so be a drip to your neighbor, do the right thing, be kind to your neighbor, talk about the issues. It's going to take all of us to do this. We need to care about each other no matter how old we are.
Janet.
Fund home-based community services. Keep people out of institutional care.
Very similar. Create community, right? Community that's going to fund it, but also community that's going to support our loved ones and our neighbors and the lady down the street and the person we haven't talked to in a year. And do it because we really want to.
So you don't have to wait for Congress or your state legislature. You can just walk down the street and help someone in your own neighborhood.
I think more of this, collaborate so that we have resources that we're educating the public. And I think at least one of you will know that the Shepherd Center provides a gateway to free food and care at home. So collaboration.
And that was our State of Aging in Kansas City. Thanks to our terrific panelists, Camille Russell, Melody Elston, Janet Baker, Dr. Jessica Callender-Rich, and Samantha Shepherd. Thank you so much. And to our sixth panelist, which was you. I'm Nick Haines. If you're navigating these issues, just beginning to think about long-term care, don't know how to get the resources, we're putting all on our website for you at kansascitypbs.org/aging. From all of us here at the Kansas City Plaza Library, be well, keep calm, and carry on.
Produced with the generous support of the William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee, Hush Blackwell, and by viewers like you. Thank you.